Oh, hey, didn't see you there. I was just reading How the Other Half Lives by Jacob Riis. Have you heard of him?
Looking back now, I think it was the contrast of its desolation with the green hill and the fields I loved, of its darkness and human misery and inefficiency with the valiant fighting men of my boyish dreams that so impressed me. Ribe, Denmark. In 1849, Jacob Riis is born, the third of 14 children, in a rather small town for such a remarkable boy. Ribe is a town that might be old and yet have kept step with time. In my day, Ribe had not. It had never changed its step or its way since whale oil lanterns first hung in iron chains across its cobblestone paved streets to light the night.
Born into poverty, he strives in childhood to improve the lives of those less fortunate, even sharing his Christmas present with the poorest family in his town. Riis strived to become a carpenter, having moved to Copenhagen despite his father's wishes. During his young life, finding work was very arduous.
In 1870, Riis arrives in New York at the ripe age of 21 with only $40 in his pocket. Originally, Riis surveyed the East Coast, taking jobs in construction and low-paying carpentry jobs just to stay alive. He found himself in upstate New York, working odd jobs at farms, wood mills, and railroad.
When he first arrived here, he had some very, you know, lonely and heart-wrenching experiences.
As a precursor to his later career, Riis worked at the local newspaper for a mere $10 per week. He briefly joined advertising and purchased his own stereopticon, or essentially, a slide projector. He projected images of local businesses for a little extra money, but he still hadn't found his calling. Fortunately, Jacob Riis secured a job as a reporter for a local newspaper. He started publishing dozens of magazine articles and was recognized as a growing young reporter. The upcoming young man was offered a job as a police reporter at the New York Tribune. He eagerly accepted and was soon earning $25 a week.
The news agency where he worked was located in an area that was heavily populated by European immigrants. He was always looking for fresh news, so he often went into the tenement sections late at night to search for wrongdoers. Even though he had a tough time as a European immigrant, he saw just how difficult life was for these people and decided to expose it to the rest of New York.
Highlight some of the scenarios and positions that he saw in New York at that time, in terms of tenant life and impoverished conditions.
At first, Jacob Riis hired two other people to take pictures for him. He eventually got frustrated with them and started taking them himself. The first time he went out to take pictures, he brought 12 frames and was only able to correctly expose one.
He did eventually become a talented photographer and started to experiment with the new lighting techniques such as flash power.
One of the most outstanding things about Jacob Riis is that he never thought of himself as a great photographer. He didn't make any great inventions to help the world of photography, but he did have a unique view, a view that New York really needed to see.
He first displayed his photos in a two-hour presentation at the Society of Amateur Photographers of New York. It was called The Other Half, How It Lives and Dies in New York.
Riis's book changed the course of New York City history.
While Jacob Riis began to explore photography, he wrote a book called How the Other Half Lives. It was met with great success and recognition. Many people were appalled by the shocking truth displayed in Riis's pictures. At this time, photography was still a fairly new concept. Riis had just started a new era in photography where photographers took pictures to show a story and to expose a world the viewers would have otherwise never seen. He also started a movement to change living requirements that greatly improved the lives of European immigrants. Riis's book uncovered the daily horrors and hardships that European immigrants living in tenements endured. His book, along with his photography, was one of the initial kickstarters of change in the slums of New York City. This movement eventually led to the changing of laws regarding housing requirements.
Historians say that it really was more like how the other three quarters live, and not really the other half. He himself was an immigrant, and so he really, I think, self-identifies with the individuals who are living in these conditions at the time and sees no other way but to show other New Yorkers at that time how individuals are living.
You had asked me about his legacy, and it's a little bit complicated because he foremost was a humanitarian and a writer. And in the context of his career, Riis was a photographer only for a brief part of his career. Jacob Riis is recognized as the first photographer in the U.S. to use his work to raise awareness and call for reform. Photographic record of urban poverty, and he turned to photography as a tool because he didn't think his writing was beginning to was making enough of an impact, right?
Edith Wharton's The Age of Innocence explores the lives of the New York elite during the Gilded Age. While the Gilded Age seemed evasively lovely and successful, there were many veiled problems with infrastructure, poverty, and politics within society. Jacob Riis was a major player in raising awareness of a particular Gilded Age problem, poverty.
One of the preconditions for that kind of work emerging was this belief that there's a relationship between poverty and living conditions and social behavior.
Jacob Riis is considered one of the city's first muckrakers because he took a stand against the social norms and exposed the problem. He shared with the world through his book, truly, how the other half lives.
Well, I hope you had a wonderful time learning about Jacob Riis. I know I did.